On today's show, weather hates Kyle Larson, Austin Hill threw a temper tantrum, and the Indy 500 ended in golden hour for once. Welcome back to the BrakeHard Show. My name is Matt. We had an absolute incredible weekend of racing. Well, actually, we only had really one incredible race. That would be the Indianapolis 500, as it should be, as Lee Diffie noted, and threw a little subtle jab at Formula One. This always has been and always will be the greatest spectacle in racing. 330,000-ish people on grounds at Indianapolis created for an electric atmosphere once the race finally got started on Sunday. Josef Newgarden is your winner. Of course, he goes back-to-back for the first time since Helio Castroneves did it in 2001 and 2002. Highly unfortunate. Didn't seem like the grandstands really wanted that to happen at all because Pato O'Ward got a pop from the crowd in those closing laps, unlike anything I've ever heard at the Speedway. It was louder than Helio Castroneves. It was louder than Tony Kanaan. The entire grandstands was going bonkers. As the youths like to say, it was absolute scenes. I don't know what that meant until I experienced it in person. And the people were going insane. It was really cool to see that moment. And then, of course, on the last lap, Pato O'Ward takes the lead going into turn one, and it looked like he was about to win his first Indianapolis 500. After coming so close, after having a heartbreak last year when he didn't lift, right, and spins out with Marcus Ericsson, clobbers the wall, and got out and said that he wouldn't make that same mistake again. Well, going into turn three on the last lap, he didn't make the mistake. He stayed foot to the floor, full throttle. Josef Newgarden passes him on the outside, a big balls move. And I'm not a Josef Newgarden guy in the least. I still think the guy cheated. I think he knew when he cheated, in my opinion. And I don't love the fact that he really didn't. He got off scot-free. Yeah, he lost his win. But in the grand scheme of things, that's a pretty big way to cheat. So he goes and wins the Indianapolis 500, his second 500 in a row, second, of course, ever. He joins a list of like six guys that's won two championships and two Indianapolis 500s. I absolutely don't want to see him win a third Indy 500 next year in 2025. If he does, I'll never return to the Speedway again. I just can't go for the Indy 500 if Josef Newgarden's going to keep winning like that. I'll be back, but let's be honest, I'm not going to be happy about it. Reluctantly, I'll go back. The entire race was phenomenal, top to bottom. Of course, it started off with complete chaos on lap one. We had a three-car wreck with Marcus Ericsson, Tom Blomqvist, and Pietro Fittipaldi just wanted to be involved in the accident, so he got himself included in it. Ericsson was throwing his gloves, and it wasn't a temper tantrum like Austin Hill threw a temper tantrum, but I understand the frustration from him. And then we had the Hondas blowing up because they just didn't want to be engines anymore, and Catherine Legg's car, Marcus Armstrong, and Felix Rosenqvist froze out of the race. The Swedes were just not happy. It was a bad day to be Swedish in the Indianapolis 500. Felt bad for all those guys that came from long and far and made it. I would do a Finnish accent. It's not very good, so I'm not doing it right now. The entire race, though. Like I said, great top to bottom. Kyle Larson obviously was the talk of the month, and he was the talk of the day for a while. He was in the top six basically majority of the day. On a restart early in the race, he messed up the gears, ends up, you know, going to a gear that's too high, gets bogged down and swallowed up. He goes from 6th to 14th, and then he has to kind of settle in and rebound from there. Learned a lot throughout the race. Kyle Larson's restarts, I think when he runs this race again, I'm saying when because this is a two-year deal, so hopefully he does get the chance to come back. When he runs it again, he's going to be much more aggressive on the restarts because what we saw on Sunday was him just kind of laying back, not laying back, but him not, the whole goal of the restart was to not lose positions. And he really did a good job of defending, make sure he didn't lose. And then a lap or two into the run, that's when it kind of laid out and he started to make those moves up through the field. And it worked out pretty well for him. Obviously, a speeding penalty with about 70-ish laps to go doomed his entire race, took him out of contention for probably a top five finish, top six. It probably would have been around where he shook out at. And he ends up coming home P18 on debut. Lead lap, complete all 500 miles, but certainly not the result he wanted. Of course, it rained early in the day. If you were at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway, you know exactly what I'm talking about because at about 11:15, they cleared the grandstands and everybody's like, all right, so you go back to your car, catch a nap, sit through this torrential downpour at times. Probably not as bad as everybody expected, which is a good thing, of course. Go back into the racetrack, and then when you went back into the racetrack after the rain, that place absolutely came alive. The humidity was back. That sucked. But other than that, everybody was there. Everybody was there. Packed in like sardines in the grandstand. Infield looked like an absolute mosh pit at times. When Snake Pit lets out after that concert is over, the sea of humanity that walks out of there, like zombies that aren't even aware they're on this planet, some of them, was pretty funny to watch. The outfits of Snake Pit combined with the wholesomeness that is the Indianapolis 500 for families is my favorite part of the whole thing. One girl's walking around with butt floss and pasties, and then you got a family with a little girl waving a checker flag, and her parents are like, oh, look how cute it is. The dichotomy is second to none, honestly. It's fantastic. The entire race, though, those last 40 laps, instant classic. Right? If you're playing NCAA football 14 and you have a really close game, it throws up that immediate ESPN classics, like instant classic thing. That's what this race was. The last 40 laps of this race are some of the best racing you will absolutely ever see. IndyCar nailed the aero package. Obviously, what we had from 2012 until 2017 was really, really good in terms of the package, the passing, the amount of lead changes and runs and everything that people could get. That was top notch. Probably will never be replicated. What they have right now is really close. It's super good on the speedway. And we'll get to something about that later. But those last 40 laps was just a group of guys running as fast as they could the entire time. The Scott Dixon strategy played out perfectly for him. Unfortunately, he could just never really get up there and be in contention because this was a Chevy party at the front the entire day. Scott McLaughlin led early. Stingray Robb led the third most amount of laps. I was ready to hop over the fence and start a crusade if Stingray Robb won this race, the same way they talk about in the Book of Revelations or whenever they talk about crusades. I'm not sure. I've never read it, but somebody, I'm sure, will fill me in. Thankfully, he didn't win, but that strategy looked pretty good for a few minutes. He and Connor Daly were on the same one. And then you have the Scott Dixon strategy, of course, played out. Marco Andretti wrecks out. He was on the same strategy. Marco, not his year, once again, for the 19th time, is not his year. Maybe it will be eventually. I don't think he's ever going to get as close as he did in 2006. And it's a shame for him. But he probably would have been there fighting for a top seven spot had everything played out. At the end of the race, Newgarden gets out. He climbs into the grandstand, which has become his new thing as he attempts to establish a personality. When he tries to figure out what that is, hasn't figured it out yet, but maybe eventually he'll figure it out. How old is he at this point? 32? I think people generally figure it out by the time they're 37, maybe. I don't know. Larson gets out of the car. He immediately does a TV interview. Hops into a Suburban, gets in the helicopter, flies to the airport, gets in the airplane, heads to Charlotte, North Carolina for the Coke 600. Paddle Award, inconsolable, sobbing. Felt so bad for the kid. You could just see it. He understood exactly what happened there. And honestly, I think if Pato doesn't immediately scrub speed coming off of turn two to get down to the inside to try to start that snake down the backstretch, I think if he carries his speed off the corner the same way that Newgarden did, he probably wins that race, or at least has a much better fighting chance into turn three than what he had. I will say this about Newgarden. For a guy that has been caught cheating with push to pass, certainly got a great run down the backstretch. I understand it's not the same thing. But nobody else was able to counter the pass on the same lap that they got passed on. Just saying. He was the only person that was able to do it. I know he wasn't cheating. That car definitely went through tech multiple times to figure it out. However, it is Roger's track, so maybe they didn't want to embarrass him. I'm not putting the tinfoil hat on. It's not happening. Great race, top to bottom. Larson heads off to Charlotte. Thinks he's going to get in the car for the Coke 600. That's already started at this point. Indy 500 didn't end until about 8 p.m. on Sunday night, which brings me to another point. Huge ratings. 6.5 million viewers tuned in. Peak viewership between 7:30 and 7:45. I'm not saying that the Indy 500 is going to get moved to a late afternoon start time, but what I'm not saying is they're going to consider this at some point. Somebody internally is kicking this around being like, you know what? That noon start time might be tradition. From a rating standpoint, it might be better. The blackout was lifted in Indianapolis as well because of the storms. The market share in Indianapolis was 54%. 54% of the televisions in Indianapolis were tuned in to the Indianapolis 500, and there were still 330,000 plus people on grounds. Yeah, I think it's time to end that archaic blackout. Regardless, the Coke 600 started before the Indy 500 even finished, and I don't know if anybody even tuned in for the beginning of the Coke 600. At one point, I saw one person be like, I just can't turn it over yet. I'm still, you know, working through what we just saw at Indianapolis. Coke 600 gets underway, and then it ended. It was the Coke 373.5, because NASCAR throws the red flag. 50 laps into stage three, 150 laps left in the race. Throws a red flag. Storm came through. Same storm that ruined Kyle Larson's attempt at the double because it went through Indianapolis is now going through Concord, North Carolina. And guess what? It ruined his attempt to get in the car at the 600 as well, because NASCAR goes out there and then they said they're going to dry the track. Perfect. Let's finish this race off. Coke 600 the last 2 years has been an absolute banger. Why don't we get in there and try to finish this off tonight? And then at 11:30, they were just like, race is over. Christopher Bell's the winner. What? I thought we were all committed to this. They said that the track wasn't drying fast enough because of the humidity in Charlotte, North Carolina. And listen, I wasn't there. I'm not a weatherman, not by trade, at least. I read it on Twitter, IndyCar Weatherman, NASCAR Weatherman. Shout out to both of those guys for having fantastic coverage this entire month. But it felt like a cop-out. Weirdly enough, too, Fox announced the winner before NASCAR had declared a winner. So a lot of people put their tinfoil hats on and were like, oh, did Fox pull the plug on this? Is Fox being petty because they don't have the Coke 600 next year? I don't know. That's what people are saying. That's not what I'm saying. You know, one of the guys that was there last night. So they end up doing that. Christopher Bell wins. Kyle Larson literally got out of the helicopter, sprinted to his pit box, throws his Hans on, throws his helmet on. He's ready to get in the car for Justin Allgaier. They red flagged the race, and the guy just looked devastated. His entire day. They had planned all of this out to run the double. And he got to do none of it. Well, he got to run the 500, but he didn't get to attempt the 1,100 miles. He didn't even get to attempt the Coke 600. And it felt lackluster. He put out a long post on Monday morning and just talking about how devastated he was, how he feels like he let everybody down. And obviously he can't control the weather, but I really hope he gets another run at it. Christopher Bell picks up his second win of the year, led the race high most laps. Brad Keselowski comes home in second, almost two in a row for Bad Brad there. Dr. Brad winning two in a row is just chaos for the sport if that happens. He's not an actual doctor, but William Byron comes home in third. He had a pretty stout car all night. And then I would say that this is a pretty lackluster Coke 373 and a half. It just wasn't really there. All the focus was on Larson. And without Larson there, it just kind of felt mundane. Justin Allgaier did a great job driving the number five car from the back to a P13 finish. Fantastic result for him. The whole thing, though, was just, Noah Gragson crashed out. Harrison Burton did what Harrison Burton does, which is spin and get a really bad result for the Wood brothers. Probably why he's not going to be back next year. Josh Berry got a top 10 for SHR in what I can only consider or compare to like their senior year of high school, where they know they're never going to see half these people again. And they're like, we might as well just have fun on our way out, because probably on Tuesday afternoon, they're going to get word from their bosses that that team will shutter all four cars at the end of the season. An absolute devastating downfall for that organization. Two-time Cup champions. 2020, Kevin Harvick wins nine races. 2024, they're going to be out of business. Like, what happened? I mean, I know what happened, but the downfall is staggering. So Kyle Larson never gets in the car. Christopher Bell wins the race, second win of the year, and the whole track was ready to go. They call the race at 11:30. At 11:49, Fast Car Living posts a photo from turn three. Track's dry. Why aren't we racing? Oh, we didn't want to have to start the race at 1 a.m. when they felt the track was ready. I feel like the track probably would have been ready before 1 a.m. And are we just forgetting the fact that we red flag repaved portion of Daytona? So Dave Blaney wouldn't win a Daytona 500, but now we can't wait out a little humidity? I don't know. I don't necessarily agree with it. Maybe somebody at NASCAR has a better reasoning for it. Maybe they just didn't want to stick around until 2:30 in the morning. It feels like you should try to attempt to get a crown jewel event to completion, especially if it's not raining. But neither here nor there. I'm not getting paid the big bucks to make the decisions. Contrary to what the comments say, I do not get paid by NASCAR. See, I criticized them. Not getting paid this month. So now it's time to move on to the Stephen Wallace dumb move of the weekend. Nobody ran into a safety truck this weekend. No one got hit by a safety truck this weekend. No one ran into a attenuator. But we did have Austin Hill throw a hissy fit and intentionally wreck Cole Custer down the backstretch at Charlotte Motor Speedway on Saturday afternoon. So Austin Hill, if you don't know, he's a gigantic man-child. He's a baby. He always gets what he wants. He's the Dudley Dursley of the NASCAR Cup Series or Xfinity Series. If you don't know who that is, watch a Harry Potter movie for me one time, will you? Or read a book. get a library card. You're mad about the racing, get a library card, go read, educate yourselves. Not that there's much education to be had in there, unless you, of course, are a wizard or a witch, then it works out really well for you. He bangs doors with Cole Custer down the front stretch. And when I say he bangs doors, I mean he banged the door. But in Austin Hill's stupid world, where nothing's ever his fault, the Violet Beauregard of the NASCAR Xfinity Series, I just won it now type of thing, he believes that Cole Custer door slammed him. But when you watch the replay, where did Cole door slam him at? They touched fenders. They go off into turn one. Austin Hill cuts down his right front. He crashes, takes the 00 with him. And then down the backstretch, he just loses his mind like he's Kyle Busch in 2011. Not to that dramatic of an extent, but he still is accelerating, picking up Cole Custer. The whole time, Cole's like, this is still happening. He's got his thumb out the window like, good job, bud. At what point are we going to stop doing this stupid song and dance? And then Austin Hill picks him up and turns him into oncoming traffic. And NASCAR doesn't park him. So he deserves a suspension. Austin Hill deserves a one-race suspension. On Tuesday, if his name's not in the penalty report for a one-race suspension, I'm not going to do anything. But I'm going to be mad about it. I'm just not going to actually do anything. So that is the dumb move of the weekend. I don't even think Stephen Wallace did something that stupid. But that is very stupid. Don't intentionally wreck people under caution into oncoming traffic. Boneheaded move of the weekend. Moving on to something I think needs to be addressed. IndyCar is riding a lot of momentum out of the Indianapolis 500. Fantastic finish. They have superstars. They have a following. Doug Bowles said that 70% of the people that attend the Indianapolis 500 or watch the Indianapolis 500 won't tune in again for another IndyCar race. We need to change that. And we need to change that by not going to the streets of Detroit the weekend after. We used to go to Texas to an oval. You go from one high-speed oval at Indianapolis to another high-speed oval at Texas. You introduce all these people in Indianapolis and they're like, we love this. Then you go to Texas and they're like, this is even crazier at times. And instead, you're going to send them to the streets of Detroit. And guess what? Not crazy. It's just not. You got that hokey double pit lane where they all come together at. It's just not meant for the race after the Indianapolis 500. The race after the Indianapolis 500 is in Michigan. It shouldn't be on the streets of Detroit. It should be at Michigan International Speedway on the high banks at the 2 mile and absolutely let them go out there and put on a fantastic show. That's what IndyCar should do. IndyCar should 100% go out of the Indy 500, go to Michigan, and then go to Pocono like 2 weeks later or 3 weeks later, something along those lines. Set back up the Triple Crown, make it happen. But you've instead drawn all these people in who watched a instant classic on Sunday night from the Indianapolis Motor Speedway, and you're going to send them now to watch the streets of Detroit? No, it doesn't work like that. You're not going to retain any of them, not at the same rate that you would have if you went to Michigan. And obviously, you can't just go to ovals all the time, right? This needs to be a pretty diverse schedule. But having a diverse schedule that only consists of, on an oval side, Indianapolis, Milwaukee, Iowa. Is that it? That is it. Figure it out with NASCAR and make it work, because you need to keep going to more ovals, more high-speed ovals, because the package they have at Indianapolis is going to work at Pocono. It's going to work at Michigan. You're going to put on great races, and you're going to get good ratings because of that. Going to the streets of Detroit doesn't do that. Just doesn't. Sorry to Detroit. Sorry to all the money that Roger spent. It's just not a very good and entertaining race. At least it wasn't last year. Maybe it will be this year. Who knows? But not a fan of it. Looking ahead for the week, though, we obviously are out of the month of May. Well, not the entire month of May, the Indianapolis 500 portion of the month of May, which means that we're not going to have practice on the weekdays anymore, which means what am I going to watch when I work? Nothing at this point. I actually have to do work. Stupid. Lame. So what do we have coming up this weekend? We have the NASCAR Truck Series and Cup Series at Gateway in East St. Louis, which is actually in Illinois. It's not even in Missouri. And if you're going, lock your doors. The Xfinity Series is out in Portland. Different side of the spectrum. Still recommend locking your doors if you go to Portland as well. But you can take public transit to PIR. Big fan of that. Who doesn't love a good train to the racetrack? A lot like Chicago. I know it's sacrilegious to talk about public transit and be a race fan, but let me tell you, public transit's pretty cool. IndyCar is on the streets of Detroit. I don't think you can take a train to that. Can take a bus, though. So if you want to do that, great. I'm sure Flava Flav is going to be there. Unfortunate for all of us with eyes and or ears. you might not have one of the set or the other, but you're going to be just as upset about seeing Flavor Flav as the rest of us are. He's going to be yelling willpower like he always is, and I'm just not here for it. Unless, of course, he walks out with a goddamn clock this size and has Will's face on it, might be here for it then. But up until this point, I'm tired of the C-lister who, what has he even rapped? What is his famous song? I have no idea. I only know Flavor Flav from Flavor of Love. I even had to think about that. When I was a child, shaped my upbringing. That's what Flavor Flav does to me. It just makes me rub my temples for a second. So that's what I'm looking ahead. So that's what we're looking ahead to on a positive note. On a negative note, unfortunately, I think on Tuesday we're going to learn the fate of Stuart Haas Racing, and it's not going to be a good one. And I honestly hate that. They employ a lot of people. There's a lot of good people over there, a lot of good drivers over there as well. And everybody's going to find new homes within the sport or outside of the sport at this rate. And it sucks. So probably on Tuesday, maybe Wednesday at the latest, we're going to learn the fate of that team and everybody there, which is good because they'll not be in turmoil anymore. You won't have drivers talking about basically being stuck in purgatory. Like, we have no idea what's going on. So yeah, as much as I'm not looking forward to probably what the news is going to be, that is on the downside of what we have to look forward to this week coming up. NASCAR also mentioned that they wanted to have the schedule out potentially this month. So we're entering the last week of the month. I don't think it's coming this week. We'll probably get the typical, like, oh, it's a few weeks away. And then in a few weeks, we'll get a, it's a few weeks away. And then in a few weeks, we'll get, it's a few weeks away. And it'll be October. And then we'll finally get it. And it'll look similar to what we have, just with Mexico City added. So that'll be exciting, at least. Never been to Mexico City. Might have to hop on a plane next year. Aeromexico. I think that's an airline. I'm not 100% sure. But regardless, let me know in the comments what you think about all the racing this weekend. Like and subscribe to the channel. Follow me on TikTok at BrakeHard, Instagram and Twitter at BrakeHardBlog.